Good day. For this module, we are going to discuss Unit 1 of Module 1, 4C 411-1, which is an introduction of highway and railroad engineering. So, to start off, when we talk about highways or railroads, basically, what will come into our minds would be transportation. And when we talk about transportation, this is simply defined as the movement of people or goods from one place to another. Okay, and when we move people or goods into different places, we use a system of routes that can be done by land, air, or by water. Okay, so when we talk about transportation, it would always be related to progress and development. And for transportation, we could relate it to economic development, social development, industrial development, and cultural development, in which, as we discuss the importance of transportation or the effect of transportation to these different developments, we would also see that they are all interrelated. Okay, so to start off, transportation would be a major factor in economic development, as transportation would affect economic activity through production and distribution. So in these economic activities, this will be the process in which products are used and delivered in order to satisfy human wants and needs. Okay? So, in economic development, an efficient transportation would basically reduce the cost in economic sectors. Why? Kasi, if we have a very good transportation or plan on transportation, then mabilis yung ating distribution, madali yung ating pagkuha ng supply and pagbigay ng demand to different points of our area or of our country. Pero kung hindi maganda yung ating transportation system, makita natin na mabagal dumating yung mga supplies, mabagal dumating yung products na kailangan ng humanity. Okay? So that's the importance of transportation with regards to economic development. And when it comes to social development, with progress, there will always be a transportation that follows or vice versa. So in social development, transportation is important when it comes to sectionalism, as an improved transportation would reduce this one. So what is sectionalism? It comes from the word section. So, kung maganda ang transportation system ng isang community, ng isang city, or ng isang country, nare-reduce yung restriction between different social spheres. So, kasi pwedeng makapunta yung mga nasa, yung mga mahirap papunta dun sa mas mayayamang spheres ng society. Okay? So aside from sectionalism, transportation also could bring prosperity in a society or in a community through concentration of population. How? So if you're going to observe in the Philippines, so in Manila, there's a concentration of population because we have a good transportation system. Therefore, Manila, which offers high employment opportunities and a good economy, nag-a-attract siya ngayon ng mga tao na pupunta doon. So, kung hindi maganda yung transportation network or system that connects the different cities, the different municipalities going to Manila, hindi magkakaroon ng concentration ng population, hindi magkakaroon ng prosperity. Okay? So aside from that, transportation would also be a part of safety, law, and order. Why? Essential ang transportation in cases of emergency and especially for isolated areas. A good transportation network would make us easily or will enable us to go to that area from other points. So, when it comes naman to industrial development, transportation would facilitate the movement of our raw material and other requirement from place of supply to the place of production. So, industrial development, as you can see, is very much related to economic development. So, if there's an industrial development, then it would also contribute to our economic development. Same for cultural development naman, it will be associated with social development as through transportation, there will be a wider cultural diversity, meaning connected to sectionalism, yung different cultures through transportation is able now to interconnect with each other, is able to makihablubilo sa isa't isa. So, that's the term I want to use. Okay? So, these are now the importance of transportation in the progress of a community or the development of a community. So, for transportation, as we have said, there are different modes of transportation that we have. So, this is the various conveyances or various ways of moving people, goods, or information. So, we have three major modes, that is through land, through water, and through air. So, this is for people and goods. And an additional mode of transportation specifically for information could be through space. Okay? Pero basically, pag transportation ng people, ng goods, itong tatlo yung pinag-uusapan natin. But for our subject, we'll only be focusing on the mode of transportation which is through land. Okay? So, when you talk about land transportation, there are two components that we have. So, the first one is what we call your highway transportation. The other one is railway transportation. So, what is the difference between the two? So, when you talk about highway transportation, this is now transportation of vehicles that would run on flat surfaces. While for rail transportation, this will be vehicles that would run on rails that are placed on tracks. So, both highway and railway transportation would involve vehicles that are on wheels. The only difference is on what they are running on. Okay? So, in the Philippine setting, highway transportation is controlled, monitored, or maintained under the Department of Public Works and Highways, while the railway transportation system in the Philippines is under the Department of Transportation or DOTR. Okay? So, for our highway transportation system, as of 2019, we have a total road length of 216,387 kilometers, while for the railway transportation, we have a total railway footprint of 77 kilometers as of 2017. So, as you have observed, in the Philippine setting, mas nade-develop natin yung highway transportation compared sa railway transportation. So, if we compare the Philippines with other countries such as the US, UK, so, makikita natin, or we could also involve India, for example, Japan, China. So, pag mga developing countries, mas makikita natin that it is more of highway transportation than railway transportation. Unlike four developed countries, first world countries, mas nade-develop nila yung railway transportation. Kasi, it is already a notion that if you are a first world country, hindi batayan ng pagiging mayaman ng country yung dami ng sasakyan or kung sino yung nakaka-afford ng sasakyan. It means that the public for a developed country or a first world country is that they use the public transport. So, yung sa atin kasi, kaya mas nade-develop yung highway transportation kasi pag titignan natin yung records ng registered vehicles, masyadong marami. So, pag ang ginawa natin na mas de-develop yung railway transportation system, mas bababa ngayon yung ating registered count ng vehicles. Pero medyo malayo pa. Since if we're going to compare nga the length of our highway and railway, so masyadong maliit lang yung sa railway natin. So for highway transportation the system, it covers mula Luzon hanggang Mindanao through the Pan-Philippine Highway. Unlike for the railway transportation system of the Philippines, it only caters to Manila and some parts of Laguna and other near provinces in Metro Manila. Okay? So, aside from that, for highway transportation, it is divided, or the network for highway transportation is divided into two, which is the National Highway Network and the National Expressway Network, which are parts of the Philippine or the Pan-Philippine National Highway, which is the major backbone of the transportation system in the Philippines. For the railway transportation system, though we have a very small railway footprint, it is controlled and serviced by three offices. We have the land or the light rail transit and the metro rail transit and the Philippine National Railways. Okay, so they provide services to the Philippines and they also monitor our railway transport. So basically, LRT, MRT is more of private, while for PNR, it is a government-owned or government-supervised agency. So we now differentiate or compare, give comparison between highway engineering and railroad engineering. So, highway engineering is a subset of what we call transportation engineering, which is a specialization of civil engineering. Well, for railroad engineering, it is a multi-engineering discipline. So, it does not only involve civil engineers, it could also involve mechanical and electrical engineers. Since for railroad, sa civil engineering, kasi ang hawak natin is the planning of the railways. Ang mechanical, siya yung bahala sa mechanism ng railroads. So, together with the electrical. So, it's a multi-engineering discipline. Though in planning, it would be more of the civil engineering side. So, for highway engineering and railroad engineering, they would both involve planning, design, construction, and operation and maintenance. Ang difference lang for highway engineering, it would simply involve roads, bridges, and tunnels. While for railroad engineering, it only focuses on rail transport systems. Okay? So, pag highway, it's not only about roads, it also includes bridges and tunnels. Okay? So, both now, of this engineering would ensure safe and effective transportation through our plans and designs. So So the functional classifications of highways would be the classifications or categories of highways based on its function or its purpose. So highway functions basically will be classified based on their purpose or the service provided. And it would always relate to the mobility and access they give. So when you say mobility, it simply means that or defines the traffic flow. So pag sinabi nating mobile yung highway, it means the flow is minimized, hindi traffic yung highway natin. Ang access naman would be pertaining to the frequent access points that is used by the vehicles that use our highway. Okay? So basically, access will always affect safety and operation of the highway. So for our classifications, there will be a hierarchy of the movement, which is based on the traffic volume or the number of vehicles that is passing through the highway. So the three classes or the three classifications under this hierarchy of movement would include our arterial highways, which could be a principal or major arterials or a minor arterial. The second classification is what we call the collector. And the third one is your local highway or local streets. So, dependent on the nature or type of the trip, the purpose of road and the traffic volume, yung pag-classify natin sa mga highways. So, for an arterial highway, this will offer the highest level of mobility and an emphasis on high speed, uninterrupted flow. So, highest level of mobility, ibig sabihin, dire-diretso yung flow ng traffic or ng flow ng vehicles ninyo. So, it would deliver traffic from collector roads to freeways or vice versa. So, from collector roads, pupunta yung mga vehicles sa arterials ninyo. So, a freeway will carry significant portion of our traffic volumes. And the principal arterial will be purposed for the main movement of the traffic, while for minor arterials, this will be acting as distributor of the main traffic papunta dun sa ating collector highway. For collector highways naman, this would blend the mobility and access of the highway. So, it would be wide, but not more than the arterials, and would allow a relatively higher speed limit, but would usually have low flow rate. So, mabilis pa rin yung takbo ng mga sasakyan natin for collectors, pero yung dami ng sasakyan per hour or per time is lesser compared to that of the arterial route. So, for collectors, from the word collect, they will now collect and distribute traffic from all other streets and would discharge them onto other collectors or arterial. While for local streets, they will now provide connectivity to business, residents, and other land uses. So, example ng local street that would now be from, let's say, barangay to barangay, that's a local street. Okay? So, ang session road, which would blend now mobility and access, pwede siya nating ilagay sa collector. So, session road up to yung road natin sa may BGH, so papunta sa may Marcos Highway, is now a collector. And then, Marcos Highway would be our arterial as it is one of our main routes. Okay? So, for local streets, basically, speeds will be minimized since maliit lang yung ating width ng road. Okay, so examples of your functional highways. So, arterial roads. So, malalawak yan. So, usually expressways or freeways. So, arterial or principal arterial. So, yung mas maliit ng konti, which is a major road, is a minor arterial. And then, we have collector roads. So, ito yung nagdudugtong sa local streets saka sa ating arterials. And then, local streets is from house to house or house to school. Okay? So, that's for... So, this is another diagram for us to understand what is the difference between arterials, collectors, and local roads. So, ang principal natin, ito. So, collectors are those roads collecting wherein vehicles will be moving from other collectors and other local roads papunta sa ating minor and principal arterials. Okay? So, when we design highways, hindi naman siya laging straight line lang. So, there would also be some intersections. And for our intersections, we have different types as well. So, intersections basically will be nodes in a transportation network or a highway network. And these are points at which two roads or more meet in order to form an at-grade junction. So, when we say at-grade junction, this would be junctions of the same level or intersections having the same levels. Okay? So, for intersections, we have traffic control type intersections wherein it governs the intersections for traffic streams from or traffic flows to intersect the road section. Okay, there are three types of intersections. We have the signalized intersections, the unsignalized, and the alternative intersections. Okay? So, control type based on this one. Siya yung nagbibigay nung rule o kaya kinokontrol niya yung mga sasakyan doon sa or yung movement ng sasakyan doon sa intersections natin. So, for unsignalized, they are usually controlled by yield or stop signs. Meaning, walang traffic lights, walang traffic signals doon sa intersection. So, yield lang o kaya stop sign. So, they are often or they often represents relatively low volume junctions. So, usually, pagkukunti lang yung sasakyan na dumadaan dun sa intersection, no need for traffic signals. Okay, stop signs would be used to control two-way control stops or TWCS intersections. So, for more modern intersections, we could use a yield control. So, without any signs, ang ginagamit natin ay modern roundabouts or rotondas. So, this is an example of an unsignalized intersection. So, meron lang nakalagay na stop doon. So, it means you stop so that the intersecting road or vehicles passing on the intersecting line can pass through. Still under unsignalized intersections, we have our modern roundabouts, which eliminate potential high-speed angle and T-bone crashes. So, a roundabout will be an impressive safety record and low rate of serious injury and fatal crashes. So, it would hinder or prevent these accidents from happening. So, this is an example of a roundabout. So, pag may intersection, pag may roundabout, mag-minor yung vehicle natin. So, with that, pag may roundabout, na lilimit yung movement ng high speed. Kasi usually, Accidents happen when there is very high speed on our highway sections. Okay, next type, we have your signalized. So usually it is applicable for elevated traffic volumes if we have very large traffic flow. So it uses traffic signals to control the interaction and the order of movement. So usually in an interaction or an intersection, there is two or more traffic signals. So, okay. So, nakikita dito yung, so it controls our, so an example of a signalized intersection would be that intersection along Session Road. So, the last type of intersection is what we call your alternative intersections. So, it's also known as a special intersection or the unconventional or innovative intersections. So, these intersections now would basically aim to enhance safety and operations without extensive construction or right-of-way cost. So, kung mahirap nang ayusin yung ating highway and we want to have an intersection, we could do some of these alternative intersections. And we have actually four types. We have what we call the restricted crossing U-turn, the median U-turn, this displaced left turn and quadrant roadways. So this is more of complicated intersections already. Okay? So for our terminologies, you have to be able to familiarize yourself with these terms as we will be using this all throughout our discussions for the entire semester for this subject. And also, you will also be hearing this again when we move on to the next subject, which is transportation engineering. So we have AASHTO, which stands for the American Association of State Highways and Transportation Officials, which is an agency that is set or that sets the standards and specifications and test protocols, guidelines that we use in highway engineering practice as well as transportation engineering. So we have roads and highways are defined as a strip of land that is cleared and is improved for transportation uses. So when we say roads, this is a wide way leading from one place to another with a specially prepared surface or a paved surface which vehicles can use. Highway will be those of a main road that is specially connecting one major town or city. Expressways are those high-speed divided arterial highway for through traffic with access that is partially or fully control. And we have freeways, which is an expressway with a fully controlled access. Okay? So basically, expressway and freeway are still under highways. So sa highway lang kasi, walang control or hindi kinokontrol yung flow ng traffic. Unlike for expressway and freeway, it is controlled. Okay, and for freeways, usually they will not have any toll fees. Ang expressway usually meron niyang toll fees. Then other terms that we need to know is the control of access. So control of access allows traffic to safely travel at fast speeds. Okay, so when we say full control of access, roadways are access through entrance or exit ramps that allow traffic to enter or exit the main lanes of roadway at nearly or at full speed. While for partial control access, this is a prohibited or they prohibit or limit direct access to and from adjacent private properties. So they are usually at grid intersections with crossroads in which may occur. We have ADT, which stands for average daily traffic. We also have what we call AADT, which is the annual daily traffic. So when we say ADT, that is the total volume of vehicle traffic of a highway or of a road section. So gaano karaming sakyan yung dumadaan sa isang road section in one day. Okay? So pag annual daily traffic naman, it's the same as average daily traffic, pero instead of one day ang binibilang or nire-record, yung number of vehicles na dumadaan sa isang road section for the whole year. And then you divide it by 365. Okay? And then we have directional or one-way ADT, which is the average 24-hour volume in one direction of travel. And then we have the current traffic, which is the ADT that is experienced by a highway at present condition. And we have future traffic, which is the ADT that a highway will use in the future. So usually, for improvements or recomputations, redevelopment of highways, we use future traffic of the highway. So that's for Unit 1 of Module 1, Introduction to Highway and Railroad Engineering. Thank you for listening. So if you want more references, you can use the following sites and books.